Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to give you some example of application of this technique that we saw that I would call conditioning, that consists in computing either the probability of an event or the expected value of a random variable by conditioning on a partition of omega, or by conditioning on another random variable. So, in particular, we are going to see something in spirit which is kind of important to understand is one first thing is the fact that I want to say that conditional objects in probability theory, they are not the main goal typically. Conditional objects like conditional probabilities or conditional expectation are objects that are more of interest in statistics. But in probability theory, we are mostly interested in probability, the unconditional probability of an event or expected value of a random variable. And conditioning is just a technique to obtain those unconditional quantities. So in particular, conditional objects are more means rather than the goal. Okay, the goal is not to have conditional things, it's to compute unconditional objects by using a conditioning. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that you will see through those examples I'm going to give you that the main trick in those problems is to find the correct conditioning object, I want to say, meaning on which partition should we condition or on which random variable should we condition. And so if you go back to my previous videos, you will see that we have those nice formulas that tell you how to compute unconditional probabilities or expected value by conditioning, but that those formulas don't tell you anything about how to choose the partition or how to choose the random variable on which you should condition. In fact, there is no rule. Those formulas, they apply for any partition or random variables. However, if you don't choose those objects in a smart way, then you end up with, I would say, conditional objects that you cannot compute. So the trick here is going to always try to find a nice random variable or a nice partition on which you should condition. And typically those objects are kind of natural. So that's what we are going to do in this video and the next few videos. And I'm going to start with a very popular application of conditional probabilities that consists in computing the probability of winning a game of craps. So I just remind you the rules of the game. So this game is played with two fair dice. So you roll the two dice, and after the first roll, there are three possible outcomes, three possible alternatives, I should say. So the first one is if you get a 7 or an 11, if the sum is 7 or 11, then you win, and the game is over. If at the opposite you get 2, 3 or 12, then you lose and the game is over again. But if you get anything else, so that means 4, 5, 6, 8, 9 or 10, then you have to keep rolling the dice until you get this value again or a 7. If you get this value again, this first value again, you win. But if you get a 7 first, then you lose. So for instance, if you start with rolling a sum of 5, then you are going to roll the dice again until you get either 5 or 7. If you get 5, you win. If you get 7, you lose. So in this case, we want to, of course, compute the probability of winning this game of craps. So it seems, looking at other videos on YouTube, that some people believe that the probability of winning that game is exactly 1/2, meaning that it's a fair game. I think those videos are based mostly on simulation of the games, but not enough simulations means that you get some not good enough approximation, and indeed it feels like the game is fair, but it's not the case. In fact, as usual in all casinos, all the games you are going to play are unfavorable, so meaning that in fact in this case the probability of winning is slightly less than 1/2, and we can compute it explicitly using conditional probabilities. So the goal is going to be to use this formula we saw last time that says that the probability of winning is going to be the sum of probability of winning given members of a partition, given some events that form a partition of omega. And the trick is going to be to find those events in a smart way. So first, to get started, of course, I'm going to write W for the event of winning. So W is just a short to say win. And so if you really think of, so each time you want to do a conditioning, the main question you should ask yourself is, what do I want to know? What do I need to know to make easier the computing the probability of winning? So, and so it turns out that in this case, it's clear that if you know the first sum you get, the sum of the first two dice, then that helps you to compute this probability. So, probability, computing the probability of the first sum being equal to 2, 3, up to 12, it's an easy problem. And also computing the probability of winning given that the first sum is equal to one of those values seems easier than just computing the unconditional probability of W. So that's what we are going to do. We are going to condition on the sum of the first two dice, I mean the outcome of the first roll. That's some kind of natural thing to do. So we are, strictly speaking, going to compute the probability of W by conditioning on a random variable that I'm going to call S for sum. That's the sum of two dice. Okay, and we are going to think of this sum as the first sum we get, but then at another time, and I'm still going to call it S, but that's going to be the second sum, in fact, or the subsequent sums of the two dice. So we just call S the sum of the two dice, the two pair dice. And then it's clear that according to the rules of the game, the probability of W given that S equals 7 or 11 should be equal to 1. So this conditional probability is equal to 1. If you start with 7 or 11, then you win. At the opposite, P of W given S equals 2, 3, or 11 should be 0. Now, the probability of W given that S has overvalues is more complicated. So I'm going to introduce another notation also for those overvalues. I'm going to call, let's say, F the values. So we said 2, 3, you lose. Then 4, 5, 6, you keep playing. 7, you win. 8, 9, 10, you keep playing also. And then 11 or 12, you also have, I mean, 11 you win, 12 you lose immediately. And so that's only for those six values that you will have to keep playing. So this set is play some role in the problem. And so now how can we compute the probability of winning? So first I'm going to use the fact that we proved in the previous video that the expected value of a random variable is equal to the expected value of the conditional expectation of this random variable given a sigma algebra. From that, we saw that that also relates to probabilities if you look at indicator function on some event. And so you can in fact rewrite this as exactly the expected value of the probability of W, but given the random variable S. Okay, and so have in mind that this new quantity here means it's the same as expected value of the indicator function on W given the sigma algebra generated by S. So this conditional probability in fact is a random variable, and you want to look at the expected value of this one. We know that it's the same as P of W. Now, conditioning on S by what we saw in the previous video, we know that this should be equal to the sum So now I'm going to condition on, so S means that I'm going to look at all the possible values of S and look at some of the probability of W given S is equal to those values times the probability that S is indeed equal to that. So that's going to be a sum for S equals 2 to 12. That's all the possible values of the sum of two dice of the probability of W, but given that S equals little s, times the probability that S equals little s. Okay? So we have this. Maybe to make the notation a little bit shorter for after, I'm going to introduce a new notation here. I'm going to call, let's say, PS, the probability that S equals little s. So this collection of numbers PS, they just represent the probability mass function of S. So now, what can we do from that? Well, first thing is, observe, like I just said before, that this conditional probability is equal to 0 if S is equal to 2, 3, or 11. So those terms can get out of the sum. At the opposite, if S is equal to 7 or 11, then this conditional probability is equal to 1. We know that we win if we start with 7 or 11. So that means that we have two conditional probabilities that are equal to 1 corresponding to the term for S equals 7 or 11. So this sum simplifies a little bit to P7 plus P11. Okay, I'm using this notation. And now what's left is the sum over all S in this set F, for which we have to continue playing. So then I have a plus sum. So for S in F, this set of, again, this conditional probability, but times PS. So I'm going to write PS times the probability of winning, given that S is equal to little s. So in this case, we saw that the rules of the game is probability that you win, given that you start with any number in F, is exactly the probability that you get S, the sum S before the sum 7. So I'm going to introduce a new event to describe that. So let's call it, for instance, BS. So if I call BS, the event that we get sum is S before 7. Okay, so if we introduce this event, so how can we compute? So it means exactly that this conditional probability is exactly equal to P of BS. And now the trick is to compute P of BS. And here it's interesting, this problem is interesting because we have some kind of double conditioning. We use some conditioning here, but then to compute P of BS, we are also going to use another conditioning, and that is similar to the previous one. We are going to condition on the possible values of S, but here it's interpreted in this context of the game as the sum of the two dice at the second roll, okay? But also at the next rolls in general. And so here is how it looks like. So you are just going to say that P of BS, the probability of getting the sum 7, the sum S before 7. So I'm going to condition on three possible events. Clearly, we are going to get S before 7 if we start by S, with S. Clearly, it's not going to happen if we start with 7. And then if we start with anything else, not S, not 7, anything else, then in this case, we can use a restart argument and just say that, well, after the first roll, we didn't get S or 7. So the probability of BS occurring is not affected by the first roll. The dice don't have a memory, okay? It's not because the first two dice, they didn't give you S or 7, that they are more or less likely to give you S or 7 after, so you can forget about the past and restart. So, in equation, this means that you can write P of BS as P of BS given that S is equal to S times PS plus the same with 7, probability of BS given that S is equal to 7 times P7, and plus, so I'm doing the same as here, I'm doing a conditioning on S, except that here I split it into three events that form a partition with a partition into three events, just S equals S, S equals 7, or S is anything else than S or 7, and so we get P of BS given that S is not not in the set S or 7 times the probability of this event. So the probability of this event is exactly 1 minus the probability of having 7 minus the probability of having S. So I'm going to write a 1 minus P7 minus PS. And so next step, so I'm running out of space here, but maybe, so we need this one. I'm going to erase here and write the result here. So, and this we remember, hopefully. So then from this, we can deduce, so let me remind you that one maybe, or just let's do that after. So we know that P of BS from that is equal to, so P of BS given that we start with S, what is the probability that we get S before 7 if we start with S? It's obviously 1. So this conditional probability is 1, so we end up with just PS. And then, at the opposite, this conditional probability is 0. Probability of getting S before 7, if you start with 7, should be 0, so this part disappears. And the trick is really, so let me write again this term. So after we have plus 1 minus P7 minus PS. And then we still need to multiply that by this conditional probability. And this is some interesting argument that we use here, this restart argument, or it's also called first step analysis. That's a technique we use a lot when we study discrete time Markov chain. It's the fact that because of the loss of memory, like the dice don't have any memory, they don't remember what was the previous sum, of course. That means that after the first roll, it's like nothing happened, and then the conditional probability of PBS, of the conditional probability of BS given this event, is just the unconditional probability of BS. So I can write it again here. So that's P of BS. And so from this, we see that we have an equation. PS, P7 are easy to compute. PBS is the unknown, but we have some linear equation involving PBS on both sides. Then you can just simplify here and here. And you know that this quantity here is equal to 0. And then you conclude that P of BS is equal to PS divided by P7 plus PS. Okay? So, and that's exactly from our definition of BS, we know that P of BS is exactly equal to the conditional probability of winning given that we start with a sum equal to little s for all s in F, okay? When s is in F. And so from that we can deduce that this sum should be equal to, so we still have this P7 plus P11, then we still have the sum for all S in F of, so this quantity is equal to PBS, but we saw that PBS is equal to PS divided by P7 plus BS. Be careful, you have an extra PS in front, and so that gives you a PS square divided by PS plus P7. Okay, so now we are almost done. We could compute this directly by, you know, computing all the values of PS for all S from 2 to 12. But I'm going to show you one more trick before. So if you look at the probability of, let's write them here. So if you look at the probability of having a 4, so P4 is going to be equal to, so you have to be careful when you deal with two dice like that, all the values from 2 to 12 are not equally likely. If you roll one die, then one fair die, then all the values 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 are equally likely. But with two dice, you are more likely to get the value in the middle, which is a 7. And that's easy to see just by counting even on your finger. So P4 is exactly, so the probability of getting 1, 3, or 2, 2, or 3, 1. So you have three possibilities out of 36 possible outcomes. So that gives you a 3 over 36. Then we need to do the same for a priori all those values. So then P5 is exactly the probability of having 1-4 for or 4-1 or 2-3 or 3-2. So that gives you four possibilities. So you see that P5, 5 is closer to 7, and then you have one more possible outcome. So that gives you a 4 over 36. And then same story, if you compute P6, you are going to find 5 over 36. Now, P7 that we need here is equal to, P7 is equal to 6. This one is going to be 6 over 36. Okay, and then the P11 is going to be, so there are only two ways to get 11, 5, 6 or 6, 5. So that gives you a P11 equal to 2 over 36. So you see that in my little calculation here, I skipped 8, 9, 10. That's because 4 and 10 are symmetric about 7. And same for 5, 9, and same for 6, 8. So that means, and you can again count on your fingers to check that indeed that's the case, it turns out that the probability of 4 and 10 are the same, the probability of 5 and 9 are the same, and probability of 6 and 8 are the same. And so from that, you can a little bit simplify your sum and say that the sum here over all those terms, you see here it just depends on PS, that's equal to 2 times the sum, but going from 4 to 6 only. So you can change that and say that instead, so let me write plus, so S equals 4 to 6, but then you will need a 2 here, okay? That only gives you the half sum. The sum over those terms should be the same by symmetry, and so that's why I just put a 2 here. And you see that basically we are done. Now, the last step you need to do to conclude is just use a calculator and just replace P7, P11, P4, 5, 6 by the values we wrote here. And then you would find that the probability of winning, so let me erase here so we can see clearly, is about equal to 0.4929. This is the final answer. Indeed, the probability of winning is close to 1/2. And indeed, if you keep playing the game for a while, and even if you record your score each time, whether you win or lose, you may have the feeling, even if you play several dozens of times, that the game is fair. But it turns out that, strictly speaking, those conditional techniques, those conditioning techniques, tell you that, in fact, no, the game is not fair. The probability of winning is slightly less than 1/2.